men came down from Judea to Antioch, and they were teaching the brothers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you cannot be saved. This brought Paul and Barnabas into sharp dispute and debate with them. So Paul and Barnabas were appointed, along with some other believers, to go up to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders about this question. Jump down to verse 6. The apostles and elders met to consider this question, and after much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them. Brothers, you know that some time ago God made a choice among you that the Gentiles might hear from my lips the message of the gospel and believe. God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them just as he did to us. He made no distinction between us and them, for he purified their hearts by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of the disciples a yoke that we or our fathers have ever been able to bear? No, we believe that it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved just as they are. The whole assembly became quiet as they listened to Barnabas and Paul telling about the miraculous signs and wonders that God had done among the Gentiles. When they finished, James spoke up. Brothers, listen to me. Simon has described to us how God at first showed his concern by taking from the Gentiles a people for himself. The words of the prophets are in agreement with this. There's a quotation there from the book of Amos. We'll talk about it. But look at verse 19. It is my judgment, therefore, that we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God. Let's pray and ask the Holy Spirit to come help us this morning. Lord, we thank you for this morning. Thank you for the people you love so much. Thank you for your powerful presence here and for your word. Breathe life among us. In the wonderful name of Jesus, amen. I wonder if you have ever had a run-in with a territorial saint. I had one my very first day as the associate pastor here at harvest time. Someone who had been in the congregation from the beginning came up and greeted me with these words. I just want you to know, staff come and go around here, but I stay. I said, well, thank you very much. God bless you too. You know, that was 17 years ago. I sure miss her. In the book of Acts, the apostles had plenty of run-ins with territorial spirits, demons that control regions. Peter and Philip had a run-in with a territorial spirit in Samaria, operating out of Simon the sorcerer. Paul and Barnabas encountered a territorial spirit on Cyprus, operating through Elymas in Lystra, operating out of the temple of Zeus. They would encounter more in Philippi and in Ephesus. But Acts 15 is about a run-in with territorial saints. Territorial saints are concerned about controlling the church and its ministries. It's their way or the highway. They're concerned about having preeminence because they've been in the body for a long time. They're concerned about recognition and positions. They consider themselves first in line when a ministry becomes available. Territorial saints are concerned about preserving traditions and embracing their preferences. They want to make sure that we continue doing things the way they've always been done. They're resistant to change. They're resistant to new initiatives and to new people. Territorial saints want the newbies among us to know who's boss. They want them to get in line and pay their dues. You know, as it turns out in the book of Acts, the territorial spirits were a lot easier to deal with than the territorial saints. They were a lot more predictable, and they also yielded a lot more easily to the authority of Jesus' name. You know, Jesus marveled about that in Mark chapter 3. In Acts chapter 15, Paul was trying to protect new believers from territorial saints. The newbies were Gentile Christians in Antioch and in Western Turkey, idol worshipers who had come to faith in Jesus. The territorial saints were Jewish Christians in Jerusalem, not all of them, but some of them, members of the Pharisee sect, who kept the law meticulously before they came to Christ. And they wanted the newbies to fall in line and pay their dues. They wanted them to take on them the yoke of Moses, as it was called. They wanted them to learn all the intricate Jewish laws and customs. They wanted them to go through the elaborate proselytization ceremonies culminating in circumcision. That's why they're called Judaizers. The issue created such a row in Antioch that a church council was called in Jerusalem to resolve the matter. Beloved, can I tell you that Acts 15 still matters to us today, because territorial saints are a perennial problem in the church. Jesus forewarned us in the parable of the prodigal son. Do you remember the older brother? He was home being the good son while his playboy brother was out wallowing in the pig pen. And when his younger brother finally came groveling home, the older brother was jealous at the display of joy and affection that his father put out. He had spent all that time right next to his father, but he never learned his father's heart. Jesus also told the parable of the laborers in the vineyard. The workers who had been toiling all day in the hot sun weren't happy that at the 11th hour some workers came to help bring in the harvest. They were jealous at the end of the day that the Johnny-come-latelys got the same recognition as they did. They never shared their master's urgency for getting the harvest in before sundown. All they cared about was their reward. Territorial saints are a problem because they make it difficult for new people to turn to Christ and become part of the church. As it is, the salvation of any person is a miracle of God. You know, the disciples said to Jesus, "Who can be saved?" And Jesus said, "With man, it's impossible, but with God, everything is possible." James says here in Acts 15, "Since it takes a miracle of God for anyone to be saved, then let's not make it any more difficult for those who are turning to God." So how do we tackle the problem of territorial saints? As time marches on, as we grow a little long in the tooth ourselves or a little gray in the temples, how do we prevent becoming territorial saints ourselves? And how do we prevent them from killing our effectiveness as a body? The answer is to K.I.S.S. You know the KISS principle, right? Keep it simple, saints. Let's not make it difficult for people who are turning to God. And as I look at Acts 15, I find three ways to keep it simple, saints. And I want to share them with you quickly this morning. Three ways to keep it simple, saints. The first one is this: focus on salvation. Focus on salvation. Do you know that Acts 15 is exactly the center of the book of Acts? It divides the book equally into two sections of verses. There are equal number of verses before it, and there are equal number of verses after it. And theologically, it is the center of the book as well, because it articulates so clearly what is salvation. Beloved, can I tell you, the way to avoid getting in fights over peripheral issues is to stay focused on the awesome miracle of our salvation. Some men from Jerusalem showed up in Antioch, and they began teaching something new without the covering, without the authorization of the apostles and elders. They said, "Unless you are circumcised and obey the law of Moses, you cannot be saved." The result was a deep rift in the body, with the Judaizers on one side and with Paul and Barnabas on the other side. And so they decided to go to Jerusalem to consult the apostles and the elders there and settle this matter once and for all. When the council convened, Peter leads off speaking, and he unifies everyone by reminding them of what is salvation. Beloved, can I tell you that focusing on salvation will always unify us too? because it puts us all on a level playing field. It reminds us that each one of us are recipients of unmerited grace. So what does Acts 15 tell us about salvation? Let's look at it for a minute. What does it tell us about salvation here? For one thing, Acts 15 tells us that salvation is God's initiative. Salvation is God's initiative. James says that God took the initiative in human history to bring salvation through Jesus Christ. From eternity, God knew his plan, and all the prophets foretold it, represented by Amos here. God planned to bring Jesus, the Messiah, from the people of Israel and from the lineage of David. God planned to incorporate the Gentiles as his own people along with the Jews under the umbrella of the reign of King Jesus. God planned that a new era should begin in the world where all people are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ and not by keeping the law of Moses. Salvation is God's initiative in human history. And Peter says here in Acts 15 that salvation is God's initiative in the hearts of individuals. Beloved, God personally encounters people while the gospel is being preached. You know, while I'm speaking right here this morning, God wants to come and he wants to encounter someone in this place. God chooses to give people a divine opportunity to hear the gospel and repent. Peter says it was God who chose the Roman centurion Cornelius and his friends to have the opportunity to hear. When Peter came back to Jerusalem and reported what had happened at Cornelius' house, the church replied, "What can we say? God has granted them repentance unto eternal life." When Peter and John stood in front of the Sanhedrin in Acts chapter 5, they said, "God has granted Israel repentance and the forgiveness of sins." In other words, they're saying, "God's offer of repentance is on the table to you right now. Take the deal while it's in front of you." In Pisidian Antioch, Paul told the Jews, "God sent us to speak his word to you first. But since you reject it and don't count yourself worthy of eternal life, now we turn to the Gentiles." Beloved, salvation is God's initiative in the heart of individuals. He gives people the opportunity to repent, and listen, he enables them to believe and to receive. Peter says here in Acts 15, God chose that those in Cornelius' house should hear the gospel from my lips and believe. Last week we talked about your call is not your call. Let me say that your faith is not your faith either. Saving faith is a gift that comes from God. When Paul preached at Pisidian Antioch, it says they were glad when they heard the word of God, listen, and all who were appointed unto eternal life believed. We haven't gotten to Philippi yet, but while Paul was preaching the gospel on a riverbank outside of the city gate, it says God opened Lydia's heart to respond. When Peter and John healed a crippled man outside of the beautiful gate in the temple, the crowd looked at them and Peter said, "Don't look at us. This man has been given complete healing by Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him." In that moment, Jesus gave Peter and John the faith to release a healing miracle, and he also gave the crippled man the faith to receive it. Salvation is God's initiative. God chooses to offer repentance to you, and God enables you to respond with faith. Saving faith is his gift. Paul said, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves." What is not from yourselves? Both the grace and the faith. It is the gift of God, lest anyone can boast. Beloved, salvation is completely from Him. It is completely His kindness. It is completely His mercy. It is completely His unmerited favor. It is completely His power, not by any works of righteousness which we have done, but according to His own mercy, He has saved us. What does Acts 15 tell us about salvation? Second, it tells us that salvation is the position of your heart. Salvation is the position of your heart. Listen, somebody, this morning, Peter says salvation is not a matter of attending doctrine classes and going through an initiation ceremony. Salvation is the position of your heart. He said, God, who knows the heart, accepted those who were at Cornelius' house. Beloved, God alone is the knower of the human heart. And He either accepts men or He rejects them based on the contents that He finds. When Ananias and Sapphira cooked up a scheme to gain recognition in the church, Peter said to him, Ananias, how has Satan so filled your heart that you thought you could lie to the Holy Spirit? When Simon the sorcerer offered Peter money to buy the gift of imparting the Holy Spirit, Peter said, Simon, you don't belong to this gospel. Your heart is not right with God. God told Samuel, man looks on the outside, but I look on the heart. So what is God looking for in your heart? A couple things I find quickly. One thing God is looking for in your heart is godly sorrow. While Peter was preaching in Acts 2, the people of Jerusalem were cut to the heart. Their hearts were pierced with conviction. They realized that their way of life was offensive to God. They realized they really weren't good people. They realized that they had rejected God by rejecting His Son Jesus, and they were grieved. Can I tell you that each one of us needs that moment of recognition when we realize our need for God's forgiveness and for His transforming power? I was only 8 years old when Jesus became my Savior. Never committed adultery. I never committed a crime. I never killed anyone. I never drank or did drugs. I never did any of those things. But even at 8 years old, I knew that I needed Him. I knew that I was selfish and stubborn. I knew that I was disobedient and rude. I knew that I could be mean-spirited and vindictive. I knew that I lacked self-control. I didn't have to experience all the complexities of adult life to know that I needed His forgiveness and I needed His power to change. I wonder if you've had that moment in your life. Have you come to that place where you've realized that you need His forgiveness and you need His transforming power? God is looking for godly sorrow in the heart. Jesus called it poverty of spirit in the Sermon on the Mount. What is God looking for in your heart? Another thing I find is joyful gratitude. Joyful gratitude. Before Peter finished his sermon at Cornelius' house, the Gentiles erupted in praise to God. Do you know that Acts is a book of joy? The first believers in Jerusalem were overjoyed. The Samaritan who were saved after Philip preached to them were overjoyed. The Ethiopian eunuch who was baptized in the desert was overjoyed. The converts at Pisidian Antioch were overjoyed when they heard the word of God. The Philippian jailer who was baptized in the wee hours of the morning was overjoyed. Salvation is joyful gratitude for the good news that God has extended Himself to you. It's the good news that God is reaching out to you. It's the good news that He's inviting you to come near to Him, that He's inviting you into a relationship. It's the good news that He wants you. You don't have to go through all kinds of gyrations and strange things to find God. He's already looking for you. Salvation is joyful gratitude for the good news that God has a cure-all for your sin problem. It's the good news that you can be forgiven. It's the good news that your slate can be wiped clean. It's the good news that the guilt and the shame that you've been dragging around can be lifted off of you forever. The yoke of Moses is heavy, but Jesus said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light." It's the good news that you can be changed forever. This was the good news that caused praise to erupt at Cornelius' house. All the prophets testify about Jesus, that whoever believes in him will be set free from sin in his name. That is good news. What is God looking for in your heart? Another thing I find is desire for God. James describes salvation as turning to God. Let's not make it difficult for those who are turning to God. You know, usually when we think about repentance, we think about the negative side of repentance. The negative side of repentance is what we're turning from. It's the old life of selfishness and self-pursuit and self-interest that we're turning away from. That's the negative side of repentance. But the positive side of repentance is what we're turning to. What we're turning to is Him. What we're turning to is fellowship with Him, relationship. And so salvation is earnestly desiring to know God. It's earnestly desiring to please His heart, to be like Him. God, who knows the hearts of all men, is looking for hearts like this. The eyes of the Lord are searching to and fro throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him. What does Acts 15 tell us about salvation? A third thing, salvation is receiving God's cleansing. It's receiving His cleansing presence. Peter says, God chose the Gentiles at Cornelius' house to hear the gospel and believe. God gave them the opportunity to repent. He gave them the ability to respond, and their heart moved into position. And then God, who knows the heart, accepted them by giving them the Holy Spirit and purifying them by faith. So what is salvation according to Acts 15? It is a divine moment of opportunity. God extends an invitation to you. He opens your heart and gives you the ability to believe. Your heart slips into position and God accepts you. And He sends His Holy Spirit to dwell inside of you. And the Holy Spirit purifies you from the guilt of sin. And He breaks the power of sin over your life. What does Acts 15 tell us about salvation? One last thing. Salvation is becoming His treasured possession. It's becoming God's treasured possession. James says, God chose to make them His people. Literally, that means God chose to put His name on you. Salvation is belonging to Him. Jesus said it's being held in God's hand. You become one of His valuables. What do you do with your valuables? What do you do with your good jewelry? What do you do with that little stash of cash that you're keeping on the side for when everything goes down? What do you do with the things that have been passed down from your family that are valuable to you, with your important papers, stock certificates or bonds or title deeds? You don't just leave them lying about anywhere. You don't just leave them out in plain sight. You don't leave your iPad on top of a table at Starbucks unattended and go off to the washroom. You set your valuables aside. You put them someplace safe. You lock them up. You don't let just anybody handle them. You keep track of them. You watch over them carefully. And that's what it means to be God's precious possession. It means that He has set you aside. It means not just anyone can handle you now. He's watching over you carefully. He watches you more carefully than you watch your most valuable stuff. The psalmist said, the one who watches over you never dozes off and he never sleeps. He never takes his eye off of you. Amen. So what is salvation? Salvation is God's initiative. It is the position of your heart. It is receiving his cleansing and becoming his treasured possession. And listen to me, beloved, may God give you grace. When we remember that, when we think on that, it knocks territorial saints right down to size. Because we understand none of us are here by our own merit. Every one of us is here because God's grace has allowed us to be here. So none of us has any advantage over another just because we've been here longer. You have no advantage because you've taken more discipleship classes or sat through more annual business meetings, although you do have more jewels in your crown in heaven because of that. You have no advantage because you've given more or served more. Peter said, we've all been saved the same way as the newbies, by the grace of God alone. Doesn't matter whether it was a week ago or decades ago, it is only by his grace. How do we tackle territorial saints? Focus on salvation. Second, focus on what God is doing. Focus on what God is doing. Focus on what he's doing among pre-Christians and new believers. After Peter spoke, Barnabas got up to speak. And Barnabas and Paul didn't discuss theology. They didn't debate. They didn't argue. They didn't pull out scriptures. All they talked about was what God was doing in the world. They told about healing miracles. They told about tearing down demonic strongholds over Gentile cities, territorial spirits. That they told about thousands of people coming to faith in Jesus Christ, getting filled with the Holy Spirit in Antioch, on the island of Cyprus, in Iconium and Lystra and Derbe and Pisidia and Antioch. And as they talked about what God was doing, silence fell over the congregation. This was the turning point in the Jerusalem Council. The group started out deeply divided, but by the end they were all in agreement. By the end they wrote a letter and it said it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to all of us. The turning point was when they started to focus on what God was doing. And beloved, listen, focusing on what God is doing will always bring unity here too. Focusing on miracles of personal salvation, on miracles of life transformation, on miracles of freedom from addiction and oppression, on healing miracles. See, when we focus on God's work, it helps us see how insignificant our little turf wars really are. When we focus on God's amazing work in people's lives, it helps us to see that territorial saints are out of touch with what God is doing. Pastor Tate used to say to me all the time, Glenn, just remember, when fishermen don't fish, they fight. And he was right. What a great time we had at the water baptism last Sunday afternoon. 24 people entered believers baptism. If you weren't able to join us, you missed some awesome testimonies about what God is doing. One young man flew all the way from St. Louis just to get water baptized. Last summer, a girl moved from France to Stanford. And she came into our Stanford satellite and she accepted Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. And then she brought this young man that she met at work, and he had been raised in the church, but he had wandered away from faith and from the Lord, and he reconnected with Jesus. He got transferred last fall, but when he heard that there was a water baptism, he bought a plane ticket and flew all the way from St. Louis to get baptized in his home church. So God brought a girl from France to Stanford, Connecticut to find Jesus at Stanford Harvest and then used her to bring that young man back to the Lord, and they got baptized together. There they are right there. God is doing amazing things. We had a set of triplet sisters that got baptized last Sunday. We had a mom and her kids that got baptized together. We had some friends from our Brazilian fellowship that got baptized. God's doing great things. He's doing amazing things downstairs on Tuesday night in Pathways Recovery Ministry. God is doing great things through our women's mentoring program called The Gift. He's doing great things through our discipleship classes. He's doing great things out in the dome with our teenagers. He's doing great things downstairs with our kids. Decide that you're going to become part of what he is doing. You know what? Coming right up, you have an opportunity to get involved with what God is doing. Introduce a family to Harvest Time Church by inviting them to the community Easter egg hunt. In your bulletin, there's a little flyer for the community Easter egg hunt. Now, I know you already threw it on the floor. You're sitting on it right now. You took your gum out and you put it in it and you wadded it up. Jesus will forgive you. I want you to go out to the Welcome Center. I want you to get another one. Here's what I want you to do. Get two. I want you to fill out one and volunteer to help in some way. And then I want you to take another one. I want you to pray over it. And I want you to use it to invite a family to come to the community Easter egg hunt. Can I tell you, listen, parents, I hate to bust your bubble. I have little kids too, and they love picking up the Easter eggs. But I tell you, I care nothing about little pleasant fun time with the eggs. The whole point of the community Easter egg hunt is to get people here who have never been here before and to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. It's to tell them the story of Jesus' great love. It's the eggs are just a way to get them in. Invite somebody to come with you. Invite somebody to come on the Good Friday worship celebration. Our goal is to have 500 first-time guests that night. That means that every one of you needs to come and you need to bring some people along with you. Lee Rousen from the New York Giants is going to be with us, a two-time Super Bowl winner. Pastor Jason has a great night of worship planned. We're going to be sharing the gospel briefly. I'll be shorter than I usually am. And we're going to believe that in that moment, God is going to make an appointment in heaven's calendar, and he's going to give some people sitting in the Palace Theater an opportunity, and he's going to give them the ability to respond, and the miracle of saving faith is going to happen that night. Let me say to those of you from Westchester and from Yonkers and from the Bronx, just suck it up, all right? You know what? I know Stanford is a few minutes further than the church. It's about 20 minutes more, but you can do that. Jesus went all the way to Calvary uphill with a cross beam on his back to save you on Good Friday evening, the night that we remember his sacrifice. You can drive in your nice cushy car 20 minutes further to Stanford to bring some people with you to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm being a little bold. You love me anyway? That's for my Bronx friends. I'm being a little Bronxy right now, all right? I'll go back to Greenwich in a minute, okay? I'm just being a little Bronxy just for a second. Invite someone to come with you on Easter weekend. After Easter, the Lord's put something on my heart that we've never done before. He's put a series on my heart called Clean. And I'm so burdened for people who are bound and who are addicted to life-controlling problems and substances. Do you know 50% of the American adult population is addicted to some kind of drugs or another, over-the-counter prescriptions, things to help them go to sleep at night and get up in the morning? I believe that God has an answer for that. And we're going to begin targeting people. We're going to ask you to begin targeting people in your life who are bound by life-controlling problems and begin bathing them in intercession. And we're going to get them here and believe that the power of God is going to fall in this place and set them free. We're going to have a pot Sunday. We're going to get rid of pot. We're going to deal with the issue of marijuana, and we're going to have some people lay down and surrender it, and the power of God is going to break them free from that addiction. We're going to have an Ephesian bonfire. We're going to bring some stuff to the fire, and we're going to burn it, and we're going to get it out of our lives. Now, if you throw the pot on the fire, we're going to make sure that we're all standing not where the wind is blowing, all right? We're going to make sure the wind's blowing in the other direction, away from us. I want every one of you to be part of it. I need your help. I need you to pray. I need you to begin targeting people and interceding. Get them here. I need you to be facilitators on Wednesday night. We're going to have a special class. on Wednesday evenings where we're going to teach the Word of God and believe that God's going to encounter people as His Word is spoken over them. Get involved with what God is doing. You know what I love about Peter? Peter never stopped sharing Jesus. Years after Pentecost, Peter was still out on the streets introducing people to Jesus. Peter attended the Jerusalem Council, not as the administrative head of the church, but as a missionary. Peter's heart was for evangelizing, not for controlling. He left the work of managing problems to James and the elders. He immersed himself in the work of salvation. I want to become more like Peter. As the years wear on, let's resist becoming territorial saints ourselves. Let's be like Peter and Paul and Barnabas. Let's be out on the front lines of what God is doing among pre-Christians and new believers. Let somebody else manage the problems. Let somebody else fight turf wars and fight over who's in charge of what. Let's be one of those ones that are out on the front line and can stand up in the midst of the assembly and say, "Here is my friend. He accepted Jesus. Look what God is doing." How do we tackle territorial saints? Three ways to keep it simple, saints. Number one, focus on salvation. Number two, focus on what God is doing. And finally this, focus on the unity of the body. Focus on the unity of the body. Peter spoke about salvation. Then Barnabas got up and he spoke about what God is doing. And finally, James got up and he spoke about the unity of the body. He determined that nothing should be added to the gospel of salvation by grace. But for the sake of the unity of the body, he asked the Gentile believers to show sensitivity to the Jewish Christians in four matters so that they could continue sharing table fellowship together. Do you know there's a whole nother sermon in that, and our friends from Messiah's House are going to help us with that one. But we need to focus on the unity of the body too. A few principles I see from the Jerusalem Council very quickly. Number one, practice humility. Practice humility. Beloved, look at me. Let love for Jesus, let love for the gospel and for His church trump every personal offense, every preference, prejudice, and loyalty that you have. That's good preaching right there, so I'm going to say it again because I don't think it got into your spirit. Let love for Jesus, let love for the gospel and for His church trump every personal offense, preference, prejudice, and loyalty that you have. If you're going to do it, do it. The Jerusalem Council was a spectacular display of humility. Look at Peter's humility. Prior to the Jerusalem Council, there was an incident in Antioch between Peter and Paul. Paul writes about it in Galatians 2. Peter was there out on the streets ministering among the new believers in Antioch, and he was eating, having table fellowship with the Gentile believers. But when some brothers from Jerusalem came, Peter and Barnabas pulled back and they stopped eating with the Gentiles. They only ate with the Jewish believers, and Paul came absolutely unglued. He publicly rebuked Peter sharply. He was over the top harsh with Peter. He humiliated Peter in front of the church. Even so, in Jerusalem, Peter was quick to speak up on Paul's behalf. Antioch was Paul's turf. He was in charge there, but no one was more influential in Jerusalem than Peter. Peter could have taken the opportunity here to even the score. "I'll show you. Rebuke me publicly. Now we'll see." Or he could have just stayed silent and fallen back and left Paul out to dry. But listen to me. Peter loved Jesus. He loved the gospel and he loved the church too much to let a personal offense prevent him from offering his very best on Paul's behalf in that moment. You know, Paul was humble here too. Although Paul was the leader of the dynamic duo, Paul and Barnabas, Paul dropped back and he let Barnabas take the lead. Barnabas was beloved in Jerusalem. Barnabas was the best man for the job on this occasion. And so Paul was gladly willing to play second fiddle to Barnabas here. The unity of the body was at stake, and it was far more important to Paul that the unity of the body be preserved than to receive recognition as the guy who's the leader out on the field. Beloved, everybody look at me, and may God give you grace. Maturity means that sometimes we realize, although I may have taken the lead in the past, I am not the best person to take the lead this time. Face the fact that there might be someone better for this job than you. Someone might sing better than you. Someone might play better than you. Someone might be a more creative leader than you. Someone might be able to motivate, move people better than you. Someone might even be able to preach better than you. I highly doubt it, but you know, it's possible. Someone might be able to. Be humble. Look at James' humility. This was not the disciple James, the brother of John. He was martyred about 3 years before this. This was James, the half-brother of Jesus. James was known for his devotion to prayer and the law. His preference was the Jewish customs, but he was willing to set aside his preference for the sake of the unity of the body. James took a huge risk here. He risked alienating the hometown crowd in Jerusalem by siding with Paul and Barnabas and the Gentile believers. But he refused to let the good old boy network in Jerusalem prevent him from standing up for what was right and true. Beloved, listen to me, because this is worth the price of admission this morning right here. Christian leaders don't take sides in a conflict. They battle for issues, not for sides. That's good preaching right there. Some of you need to get the tape and listen to that again so it sinks in. In fact, James' decision here was the beginning of the end for the Jerusalem church. By welcoming the Gentiles into the church as Gentiles, they forever alienated the Jews in Jerusalem. Focus on unity. Practice humility like they did. Secondly, trust your leaders. Trust your leaders. Pastor Jason, you can come. Team, you can come. Everybody look at me. The trouble in Antioch started when some men went out without the covering of the apostles and the elders. They went out without their guidance. They went out without their blessing. They went out without their prayers of intercession. Beloved, everybody look at me. Beware of people who minister without a covering. Don't follow people who refuse to follow others. They will lead you into trouble. The Roman centurion said to Jesus, he said, I am a man under authority and I have people who are under my authority. Jesus marveled that the Roman centurion had more insight into the workings of the kingdom of God than God's own people. Even Peter, listen, even Peter was the lead apostle. Even Peter submitted to the authority of the church council under James' leadership. Peter could have stood up and said, I'm Peter. Jesus gave me the keys to the kingdom. Jesus said to me, not to y'all, he said to me, on this rock I will build my church. I was at the tomb on resurrection morning. I stood up on the day of Pentecost and said, this is that which was promised by the prophet Joel. I took the lead on the healing of the crippled man outside of the beautiful gate. I was sprung by God from prison twice. I stood up to the Sanhedrin. I took their beatings. God gave me the vision to go to Cornelius' house and preach to the Gentiles. I'm Peter, do what I say. But Peter didn't bully the council. He submitted his testimony for their prayerful consideration and waited for James' verdict. You know, Peter was walking on the water while James was still not a believer yet in Jesus. Jesus' brothers came and wanted to take him away in a little white truck, in a little white coat, because they thought he was crazy. Peter was already following Jesus when James had no idea who his brother really was, but he submitted himself. That's good preaching right there. The Jerusalem Council happened behind closed doors. It was a conclave. The apostles and the elders, they deliberated privately. And when they announced their decision, the whole church rallied around what they decided. Beloved, trust your leaders. Trust us to be thoughtful and prayerful. You know, the board and I never make a move without a tremendous amount of prayer and discussion and thought. We never make a move without consulting our district superintendent, without consulting the apostolic father that God has connected to our congregation. Trust us. Trust us to make decisions that are in the best long-term interest of our body with integrity and compassion. Trust us to hear from the Holy Spirit. On Wednesday evening, we're going to select two new members to our board. Pray for us so that with every decision that we make in 2013, we can say it seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us. Focus on unity. Practice humility. Trust your leaders. And this is the last thing. Grow old gracefully. Grow old gracefully. Acts 15 is the last mention of the apostles in the book of Acts. It's the last glimpse of Peter. And Peter makes his grand exit off of the stage using all of his influence and using all of his experience to prepare the way and open doors for the next generation of ministry. Decide now, however old you are, whether you're just starting out, whether you're somewhere in the middle, or whether you're getting close to the finish line, decide now that you're going to go out like Peter. As time marches on, gracefully accept that there are others who are coming up behind you and they will take your place. Don't compete with them. Open doors for them. In fact, you open the door and hold it open and let them pass through ahead of you. Personally, I'm not upset that at the 11th hour, God is sending more workers in to get the harvest in. I'm getting a little tired. The sun is going down. The shadows are getting long. The day is almost ended. Jesus is coming soon. Thank God for sending more laborers into the harvest to win as many people as we can before Jesus comes back. James advocated for a decision that would allow the gospel to grow on and on and on to the detriment of his own personal ministry. These men give us an example of how to go out. Go out encouraging the young. Even if they're a little bit brash, support younger leaders when they rise to positions over you. Submit to them. Don't you hold anything back that you have that can help them. Go out engaged in evangelism. Don't worry about control. Just go win souls. Go out as an intercessor. Be a silent partner with younger leaders in prayer. Give, serve, love, strengthen the body any way that you can with all the strength that you have left in you. How do we tackle territorial saints? How do we prevent from becoming one ourselves? How do we prevent them from making it difficult for others to turn to God? Just by keeping it simple, saints. Focus on salvation. Focus on what God doing, and focus on the unity of the body. Would you stand together and would you offer a great big praise to Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Oh, come on, let's give Jesus a big praise in this place. Come on, let's give Jesus a big praise. Come on, let's give him a big praise in this place. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, O Lord. Thank you, O Lord. Come on, lift up your voice. This is my desire.
This is my desire.
Let's make it a prayer. Lord, I give you my heart.
Oh, Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath that I take, every moment I'm away.
Come on, Lord, I give you,
oh Lord, I give you my heart, I give you my soul, I live for you alone, every breath that I take, every moment I'm away,
please have you lift up your hands all over this place. And would you just make that your prayer? Lord, have your way in me. Come on, would you say it? I can pray about you, but I can't pray for you. Only you can give him permission. Just right now, lift your hands to heaven. Just say, Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, have your way in me, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Would you bow your heads all over this place with me? We have to go. Our time is up. But before we leave, I have to ask this question today. Can't help feeling while I was speaking that God was personally encountering someone. God is extending someone an invitation. He's giving you a divine opportunity to hear and to respond. God wants to come and he wants to give you the miracle of saving faith. Your heart is slipping into position. God's ready to accept you. He wants to send his Holy Spirit. Such good news. Such good news. My slate can be wiped clean and I can be set free from the things that hold me in their power. He's ready to make you his valuable possession. All heads are bowed all over this place. We have to go, but I can't go before I ask. I wonder, is it you? Come on, has God been speaking to you? Is there something stirring in your heart right now? And you want to take that step of accepting Jesus, of saying yes to him, of surrendering your life. You've never done it, and today is the day you want to invite Jesus into your heart. While heads are bowed all over this place, if that's you, I want to lead you in a prayer to do that. And I want to ask you to slip your hand up high wherever you are. Come on, there's one. Come on, is there someone else? Today I want to receive. I want to surrender to Jesus. Come on, your heart is sliding into position right now. And God is ready to accept you. He's ready to receive you. Being a Christian isn't taking classes and going through a ceremony. It's receiving, saving faith. It's the position of your heart. Come on, there's one. There has to be another. Ooh, they always come two by two. Come on, there's more. Who else? Put your hand up high. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Not going to embarrass you. I'm just going to say a prayer with you right now in this moment. Come on, somebody else in this place. I want to receive Jesus right now. I want to invite him in. Come on, there's one. There's got to be another. Lift your hand up high real quick. We have to go real quick. Real quick. Thank you, Father. All right, let's lift up our hands all over this place, all of us. I'm going to lead in a prayer, and I want to ask you if you would follow, if you would all repeat after me. If you already know Jesus, we're going to be like four friends, and we're going to bring someone to the feet of Jesus right now. Listen, when you pray this prayer, the power of God is coming into your life. The grip of the enemy is going to be broken off of you. God's going to fill you with the joy of his salvation. His Holy Spirit is coming to live inside of you right now. Lift up your hands, everyone, all over this place. Follow me in this prayer, if you would. Let's pray. Father, thank you for loving me. Father, thank you for sending your only son. Jesus, thank you for coming. You lived for me. You died on the cross for me. Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you rose from the dead. I confess with my mouth, Jesus is Lord. Jesus, I'm turning to you today. I'm turning away from my old life, and I'm turning to you. Wash me. Forgive my sins. Wipe my slate clean. Break the power of sin off of me. Make me new. Jesus, I receive you now as my Lord and the leader of my life. In Jesus' name. Come on, give the Lord a big praise in this place. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Listen, if you prayed that prayer for the first time, I want you to come here to the altar as soon as we dismiss, and we have something we want to give you, want to celebrate with you. Do this real quick. Lift up your hands in the air right now. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I pray that the joy of your salvation would well up inside of us. Lord, with buckets, let us draw from the well of salvation. Lord, I pray that you'd remind us and amaze us again. Lord, by your grace, it was you, God. It was all you. It was your initiative. Lord, you gave us the opportunity to hear. You gave us the ability to respond. Lord, you moved our heart into position. You accepted us. Lord, you cleansed us by the Holy Spirit and faith, Lord, and you made us your valuable possession. I pray, God, that the joy of your salvation would well up inside of us, oh God. Lord, the things that we worried about, that we're concerned about, that we've argued about, Lord, I pray that they would just move way off to the sides as we focus on the joy of your salvation. God, I pray, lift up your hands. I pray that you'd make us involved in what you're doing. Others can worry about controlling. Others can worry about managing problems. We're going to go win souls. Others can worry about who does what and who's in charge of what. Lord, we're going to be out on the streets. Lord, I pray that you'd fill up the community Easter egg hunt. I pray that many new children would be introduced to our children's ministry. Pray that many new families would be introduced to our church. I pray you'd help us to fill the house to overflowing on Good Friday. Lord, I pray that right now you'd put on our heart, someone to target in prayer, Lord, a friend, a family member, a coworker, a neighbor, Lord. I pray you'd put someone on our heart. Give us a prayer burden, Lord, to intercede and pray. I pray, God, that you would write appointments in heaven's calendar for Good Friday evening, Lord, and that that moment, the miracle of saving faith would happen at the Palace Theater on Easter weekend. And Lord, as we start this new series called Clean, I pray, oh God, that many people who are bound by the power of the enemy, who are addicted to pot and drugs, Lord, who are addicted to prescription over the counter, Lord, I pray people who are bound by the enemy's oppression, depression, God, I pray that the power of God would come down in this church after Easter, Lord, like we haven't seen, that the kingdom of God, Lord, would come and visit this place and set people free. Take somebody's hand real quick. And Father, I pray that you'd make us one. Even as you and the Son are one, I pray, Father, you'd make us one. Holy Spirit, bring unity in the bond of peace. I pray you'd help us to practice humility, to trust our leaders, to grow old gracefully. God, I pray that you'd unite us with our Jewish brothers and sisters, Lord, who become believers in Christ. I pray that the miracle of table fellowship between Gentile believers and Jewish believers would happen right here in this sanctuary. I pray that you'd show us the way, God. I pray that a new sensitivity to Jewish believers and their needs and their concerns, Lord, to Jewish pre-Christians. I pray that you lead us, Holy Spirit, God, and that the miracle, just like in the first church, the miracle of table fellowship between Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians would happen here. God, I pray the power of the first century church would be ours. I pray that the grace of the first century church would be ours. I pray that the authority and the boldness of the first century church would be ours. Now, Father, bless your people.